Next up, we have Ken Davidson from Brookhaven National Lab. He is going to be talking about the, evaluating patterns and drivers of leaf water use efficiency with ontogeny in eastern deciduous forests in New York State.
All right. Thank you so much, Katie, for that introduction. Hi, my name is Kenneth Davidson. I'm a fourth-year PhD student at Stony University and a researcher at Brookhaven National Lab. And today I'm going to be talking with you all about some of the work that I'm doing, which has been funded by the David Redden Conservation Science Award grant. So first, I want to give you guys
sorry to interrupt. We're seeing the kind of presenter view rather than the full screen.
It's the other. Okay. I was worried this might happen. Now are you seeing the... Okay.
Yes, that's good. Thank you.
Sorry about that, everyone. First off, I want to give you some background on my research group and what we study. So we're the Terrestrial Ecosystem Science and Technology Group at Brookhaven National Lab. We're a multidisciplinary team whose goal is to
improve... Actually, I think we're just seeing your background. Sorry.
Okay. Now what are you seeing?
Yes.
Okay.
What is test and what do we do?
Yeah. Yep. All right. You'd think after, you know, 17 months, I'd figure out Zoom. But anyway, so we're a group of both measurers and modelers. And all of our models are designed to explore new dimensions of vegetation function. We also strive to make our measurements scalable, for example, from leaf to canopy to whole forest. And we use a modX approach. So you can see this figure here, in which basically it's a cyclical situation where measurements target uncertainty in models, and models are evaluated based on new experimental data. So just for some background, what are Earth system models? Well, they're mathematical models used to represent the fluxes and stores of matter and energy across the globe. They're omnibus models, meaning that they're made up of many smaller submodels, for example, vegetation models and atmospheric models. They're coupled in space and time, so adjacent cells within the model impact each other, and prior states impact subsequent states in the model. And our group specializes in leaf-level models. These can be broken down into three main components: photosynthesis models, which deal with carbon capture by the leaf; transpiration or conductance models, which deal with water exiting the leaf; and energy balance models, which deal with incoming radiation and outgoing thermal energy. So first, let's dig a little bit deeper into photosynthetic models. So I like to think about photosynthetic capacity like a car engine, so a bit of deja vu here, but so it's regulated by three main factors, two of which, VC max and J max, regulate how much carbon is captured. You can think about that as the horsepower of the car. And the third, respiration, relates to how much carbon is lost. You can think about that as the idle of the car. So in this analogy, we have two very different cars. On the left here, the Formula One race car is an acquisitive leaf, meaning that it has a high carbon capture rate, but also a high respiration. And on the right, you've got a conservative leaf with low carbon capture ability, but also a very low idle rate in the Toyota Prius here. And so looking at this relationship across a range of light, we get a more full idea of the dynamics of the two leaves. You can see that the acquisitive leaf captures much more carbon at high light. However, because it has a higher respiration rate, it loses more carbon at low light. And it's important to note that carbon capture and loss are not always correlated. However, oftentimes higher VC max leaves also have a higher respiration rate because of the additional cost of carrying around that photosynthetic apparatus. And understanding the ratio of these two key factors is essential to accurate estimates of net primary productivity for a forest. Now talking about stomatal conductance, the process by which the leaves lose water. Most of our models are based on the idea of stomatal optimality. That's the theory that predicts that carbon is purchased at a cost with respect to water. So it's an economic analogy. Plants have evolved to spend as little water as possible per unit of carbon. This means that some plants are conservative with respect to their water use and some are profligate. So on the left, we have the wasteful monopoly man, the profligate leaf. And on the right, we've got the thrifty monopoly man, the conservative leaf, does not spend a lot of water per unit of carbon. And again, looking at this with some synthetic data, we can compare two leaves, one with a high water use efficiency and one with a low water use efficiency. The relationship between stomatal conductance and photosynthesis is thought to be linear under most circumstances. So the slope is inversely proportional to water use efficiency. With two different slopes, two different leaves, at the same rate of photosynthesis on the x-axis, they have markedly different rates of stomatal conductance on the y-axis. So jumping back to the beginning of the talk, why does this matter? Why do we really care about this? Well, stomata are probably the most important organ on the planet, as they duly control both carbon gain and water loss from the majority of vegetation. And we really lack a very clear understanding of what controls this behavior, especially with respect to leaf development. So this means that when we look at an uncertainty analysis of most ESMs, water use efficiency is the second largest uncertainty beyond full plant respiration. And it's a pretty low-hanging fruit to study. So my project this summer at BlackRock seeks to understand both the patterns and seasonal shifts in water use efficiency and the drivers behind these shifts. So a bit about our methods. I'm studying 8 different tree species found at BlackRock. We're using shotgun sampling to knock branches out of the canopy so they can be studied back in the lab. All of my sampling occurs between first light and sunrise, so it's pretty long days for us. And this sampling requires very strict safety protocols and a little bit of a skill with shotgun, so it helps to be a crack shot. We use commercially available gas exchange systems to measure photosynthesis. These systems compare the level of carbon dioxide and water between a sample and a reference gas stream, and they allow us to control the environmental conditions around the leaf to simulate naturally occurring environments. We conduct response curves, which are long measurements used to manipulate the environment and propagate changes in stomatal conductance. In this case, we're decreasing the light level in a stepwise fashion from saturating down to complete darkness, and then we're extracting photosynthesis conductance rates from each light level. From this curve, we can extract the slope, defines the inverse proportionality to water use efficiency, the intercept, which is the level of stomatal conductance at the light compensation point, which is a really critical parameter. It's the intercept of that model. We can also estimate VC max, the carbon capture, one of the main carbon capture abilities of the plant, from the saturating light measurement, and estimate respiration from the dark measurements. We also use spectroradiometers to collect more detailed information on leaf reflectance. These data can be used to estimate biochemical, physiological, and structural properties from the leaf, and will hopefully enable us to scale our measurements up to the full landscape using remote sensing platforms such as UAS. They're fast, easy, and cheap, and provide a ton of data. I'm also using some hydraulic methods to assess plant fitness and determine resistance to change in stress over ontogeny. Here I've got shown a pressure volume curve, which gives us information on the leaf water potential at turgor loss point, which is a really good stress indicator. And finally, I'm collecting data on leaf functional traits related to growth, metabolism, and gas exchange. If you think about from a medical analogy, leaf functional traits are kind of like the vital signs of a leaf. So when you go into the doctor, they get your height, your weight, your blood pressure, your blood oxygen. That's kind of the functional traits for humans, but in this case, it'd be functional traits for leaves. So now some very, very preliminary results, hot off the press. In fact, week 3 was just last week, so very early on. So in all these graphs, you'll see 3 different weeks. Week 1 was mid-May, week 2 was May to June, and week 3 was mid to late June, so last week. Here we can see dynamics of VC max. So thus far, we've observed a slight increase in VC max for maple and for our 2 oak species. However, there has been no change in birch. We would a priori expect an increase in VC max towards a peak around midsummer as plants try and assimilate as much carbon as possible in the first half of the growth season. So we've started to see that, not so much in birch. More interesting result here is we've also observed a concurrent decline in respiration for all species. So this indicates that respiration costs have reduced even as VC max increases for some species. So those two parameters are decoupled. This can be indicative of lower cost to maintain photosynthetic apparatus in the more mature late season leaves or mid-season leaves, or it could be related to a decrease in leaf expansion rate as we've moved past leaf flush now that the leaves are basically steady state and continuing to grow. The dynamics of water use efficiency are a little bit less clear cut. Maple has increased its water use efficiency, birch has decreased its water use efficiency, and there's not much of a trend in oak. We would expect water use efficiency would increase towards the midsummer peak as water becomes more of a limiting resource and as plants shift to a more conservative strategy. So it'll be interesting to see how these dynamics change as it gets hotter and drier in the forest as the summer goes on. And finally, a really interesting result, G0, so this is the minimum conductance at the light compensation points, which is the transition from positive photosynthesis to negative photosynthesis, negative net photosynthesis. So it's declined for all species since the first week of measurement. And this suggests that the plants have become much stronger in their control over their stomata since the beginning of the growth season. And I can definitely attest to this. They've become a lot more grumpy and a lot harder to measure stomatal conductance on. So they're a bit more picky. So why does this all matter? As we all know, forests in the northeastern US have seen shifts due to anthropogenic climate change. And we need to ensure that our estimates of temperate gas exchange are accurate if we want to understand how climate change will impact forests like Black Rock. Data on water use efficiency and photosynthesis can also help in management as we can identify species which may be more vulnerable to others than change. And as always, our models are really only as good as our weakest assumptions. So if there's an uncertainty and that propagates into the model, it can cause major problems. So what comes next for this work and for myself? First, I need to finish collecting data this summer, but after that, we'll place the data in a modeling context and figure out if the models agree with reality. We'll work on scaling this data up, then perform some uncertainty analysis to figure out what the models can improve upon, and formulate new experiments that are designed to understand what the weak assumptions are in the model. Like I said before, the model is only as good as its weakest assumptions. And with that, I'd like to conclude, but first I need to and want to thank Black Rock Forest for enabling this research to the David Redden Conservation Award. I also want to thank Grayson Badgley, Matt Brady, Matthew Munson, and Katie Trilitzy for their assistance thus far in getting me out of a few jams. And finally, I need to thank my home institutions, Brookhaven National Lab and Sternberg University, as well as the U.S. Department of Energy Office of Science for funding for this. And my collaborators, Julien, Lamour, a postdoc at Brookhaven, Shawn, Serbin, my advisor at Brookhaven, and Anna McPharren, a fellow PhD student at Stony Brook University. And with that, I'll take any questions you might have.